Hello everyone. Let us now look at the volumetric properties of pure fluids. Why should we study the volumetric properties of pure fluids? In order to calculate the work and energy requirements in any chemical industry, we require the enthalpy and internal energy data. The enthalpy and internal energy data are evaluated from the measurements of volume as a function of pressure and temperature, that is, from the PVT data. The PVT diagrams. In order to study the PVT behavior of fluids, we can make use of two diagrams, the pressure temperature diagram and the pressure volume diagram. The main difference between the two is that the two phase region is shown as a curve in the pressure temperature diagram, whereas it is shown as an area under the curve in the pressure volume diagram. For example, consider the vapor liquid equilibrium. The vapor liquid equilibrium is shown by the curve joining point 2 to point C. Whereas in case of the PV diagram, the same vapor liquid equilibrium region is shown as the area under the dome as shown here, the liquid vapor region. This is the PVT diagram in 3D, that is the three axes, temperature, volume and pressure. For our convenience, we either study the PV, that is the pressure temperature behavior, that is at a constant volume, or the PV, the pressure volume behavior at a constant temperature. And these curves, the dotted curve is an isotherm, that is plotted at a constant temperature. And the point C is known as the critical point. Coming to the virial equation of state, it can be seen in the PV diagram that for the isotherms which are at temperature at high temperatures, the pressure volume relationship is quite simple. That is, as the pressure increases, the volume decreases, such that the PV, the product PV, is almost constant. So this gives rise to the virial equation of state. So we express PV as a function of P in the form of a polynomial, and by further simplifying it into the Z form, that is in the form of compressibility factor. Z is the compressibility factor, which is an auxiliary property, PV by RT. So in form of Z, we get the following two equations, one in terms of pressure and the other in terms of volume. So the parameters B, C, B dash, C dash, these are known as the interaction parameters. So the second B is the second coefficient. It represents the interactions between two molecules. C represents the three body interactions. And the higher terms usually represent the higher body interactions. And since these are usually rare, we can truncate this infinite series expansion to the first two or three terms, and this will be sufficiently accurate for many purposes. These coefficients B and C are experimentally determined, and a wide data bank is available for various substances, particularly the second virial coefficient. These coefficients are dependent upon temperature. The simplest case of the virial equation of state is the ideal gas equation. When according to the ideal gas theory, there are no forces of interactions between the molecules in a gas. So which means that all these interaction parameters will become zero. In that case, we'll have the equation Z is equal to 1, which means PV is equal to RT, which is the well-known ideal gas equation. So according to the ideal gas equation, the enthalpy and internal energy are purely functions of temperature only. Now, once we know the ideal gas equation, we can use it to calculate the work and energy requirements for various processes, such as a reversible isothermal process, a reversible adiabatic process, a reversible isochoric process, and isobaric process, and even for isotropic process. Once we have developed analytical relationships to calculate the work and energy requirements of these reversible processes. We can also use them to calculate the work and energy requirements for irreversible processes. However, there is another step involved while calculating the work and energy requirements for irreversible processes. That is, we assume a reversible process which gives the same change in state as the irreversible process. But then we need to multiply or divide it by efficiency, depending upon whether work is being input into the system or work is being done by the system. So this advantage of finding the work and energy requirements of irreversible process is based on the fact that the properties, internal energy, enthalpy, are state properties. That is, they depend only on the initial and final states, but not on how the process is achieved, whether it is irreversible or reversible. It is immaterial. The cubic equations of state. So the virial equation of state are suitable to represent the behavior of gases at the moderate to low pressures. And in order to represent the behavior, PVT behavior of both liquids and gases over wide range of temperatures, and yet to be not very complicated, the cubic equation of state actually satisfy both the requirements of robustness and of being robust and but not too complicated. So the cubic equation of state, as shown, gives three roots when it lies in the two-phase region. So the smallest volume root is corresponds to the saturated liquid root. The greatest volume root corresponds to the vapor volume, and the root in between has no physical significance. So this is the general form of the cubic equation of state. P is equal to RT by V minus B, and A divided by V plus epsilon B into V plus sigma B. Here epsilon and sigma are constants which are specific to a particular equation. So there are several cubic equations of state, such as the Suer-Edlich-Quang equation, Peng-Robinson equation, the first one, the Van der Waal equation. In the Van der Waal equation, epsilon and sigma are zero. And A and B are the molecular interaction parameters. So B has the units of volume, whereas A represents the forces. So in order to estimate the parameters of a cubic equation of state, one method would be is to make use of the experimental data and fit it and calculate the coefficients. Another method would be to use the mathematical property that at the critical point there is an inflection. As you can see, at point C the slope is becoming zero, which means the first derivative as well as the second derivative will be zero. The second derivative will also be zero because this point is neither a maxima nor a minima. It is an inflection point. And the constants, the parameters A and B, are dependent upon the critical parameters, that is the critical temperature and critical pressure. The constants psi and omega, these are constants for a given equation of state. Sometimes a third parameter known as an eccentric parameter can also be used. The definition is given as follows. Eccentric factor is minus 1 minus log PR sat at TR is equal to 0.7. So eccentric factor actually shows the deviation of a fluid from a normal fluid. For example, what are considered as normal fluids? Normal fluids are those for which eccentric factor is zero. For example, the inert gases such as helium and neon, these are considered as normal fluids. The corresponding states correlation. Two parameter corresponding states correlation states that when all fluids, when compared at the same reduced temperature and reduced pressure, have approximately the same compressibility factor, and all of them deviate from ideal gas behavior to about the same degree. So in the two parameter model, we are only considering TR and PR. We are not considering omega. When we also incorporate omega, it becomes a three-parameter states correlation, which states that all fluids having same eccentric factor when compared at the same reduced temperature and pressure will have the same compressibility factor and deviate from the ideal gas behavior by the same amount. So there's a third method called the generalized correlations. So generalized correlations are useful, especially when there is not much experimental data available and when we need to interpolate and extrapolate. So generalized correlations are developed for the compressibility factor Z. They're in the form Z is equal to Z naught plus omega Z1. So we have charts of this kind for Z naught as well as Z1. So at a given TR and PR, we can calculate the value of Z. And omega, omega is constant for a given fluid. And by knowing Z naught, omega and Z1, we can calculate Z. The second type is the Pitzer correlation for the second virial coefficient. So the second virial coefficients can be expressed as B is equal to B naught plus omega B1. And B naught and B1 are functions of TR. So once TR is calculated, TR depends upon the critical properties, critical temperature. So once TR is known, B naught and B1 can be calculated. And the first, once the first virial coefficient is, second virial coefficient is known, we can use the relation Z is equal to 1 plus BP by RT and calculate Z. So by calculating the Z, what we are essentially doing is we are calculating the PVT behavior. That is, what is the volume of the fluid going to be at given conditions of temperature and pressure? And why is this important? So suppose in case you are designing a pipeline or designing a tank, you need to know how the pressure is going to vary with volume and temperature so that you can design all the safety valves and other features of the equipment properly. So for various sizing purposes, PVT behavior can be very helpful. Now, this is the generalized procedure to compute the PVT behavior. We need to decide whether the fluid is a gas or a liquid. If it is a gas, we can use the simplest ideal gas equation, or we can use a two-term virial equation, or we can even solve a cubic equation of state. So the ideal gas equation is the simplest one, which means all gases at same temperature and pressure will have the same volume. But in reality, that is not the case, because gases do show deviation from ideal behavior. So the two-term virial equation, it consists of the calculating the parameter B, which so that you can calculate Z as 1 plus Z is equal to 1 plus BP by RT. The third one is the cubic equation of state, where we need to first calculate the parameters of the equation of state for a given species and then solve the cubic equation using iterative techniques such as Newton-Raphson method to calculate the three roots. Of them, two of them are going to be the saturated vapor route and the saturated liquid route. And coming to the Lee-Kessler tables. So the Lee-Kessler tables are the generalized correlations. So Lee-Kessler tables are available to calculate Z directly, or you can also calculate B and then use it further to calculate Z. So when it is a liquid, we can go for the following methods. One is treat it as an incompressible liquid. The second one would be to use the Rackett equation. And the third one is to use constant beta and kappa, that is compressibility, isothermal compressibility and volumetric expansivity can be considered to be constant over a small range of temperature. The Lederson chart can also be used. Thank you.